Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this review of the Rode and Schwarz RTM 3000 series oscilloscope. So big thanks to Rode and Schwarz for putting this into my hands. I've had a few months to sit and evaluate it and play with it. Besides evaluating it for this video review, I've been using it myself in some of my work on the bench. You'll know previously I did a quick overview of the Rode and Schwarz RTB 2000 series oscilloscope. So the differences between this baby, the 2000 series, and up to the 3000 series is the 2000 series goes from 70 megahertz to 300 megahertz, whereas the bigger fella goes from 100 megahertz to 1 gigahertz. This goes up to 2.5 gigasamples. That goes to 5 gigasamples. The little one has a memory depth of about 20 million points, and the bigger one has a memory depth of 80 million points, which is really nice. Now, during this review, what I am going to do, I am going to also do a comparison between the Keysight 3000 series and the Tektronix MDO 3000 series. Now, although I don't have those in my possession anymore, I did a fairly in-depth review of the two of those side by side. I have all the key facts and figures. I kind of understand their weaknesses and strengths from the time I had them for review, and I'm going to make some comparisons with those to the Rode & Schwarz 3000 series. Now, I just want to highlight that all these oscilloscopes have their weaknesses and strengths. And probably across the board, the main functionality of an oscilloscope, they do very well. But some of them might excel in kind of the more high performance area where you're trying to look for glitches and things like that. And then some may perform better where you're trying to do in-depth analysis and capture signals over time. And I'll try and highlight those. Now, before we go to the bench, I'm just going to read out a few comparative stats. And remember, some of these are paper stats, and what's quoted or specified by a manufacturer on paper can be very different in practice once you get down to the bench. Now, once we get down to the bench, I'll give you a quick tour before we kind of get into the more in-depth stuff. And towards the end of the video, I'm going to demonstrate a nice high voltage differential probe that was put into my hands and a current probe that Rode & Schwarz gave to me. Right then, so just before we get down to the bench and have a look, let me first of all talk about pricing and potential options that are loaded on this. So basically what I want to warn you is that the unit I've got is a 1 gigahertz unit, it's a top end unit, and it's fully loaded. It's got just about all of the options enabled. Now, those options can be very expensive, but what we'll do, when we get down to the bench, I'll show you the screen so you can see what those options are. So for instance, I'm going to be demonstrating something like segmented memory. That doesn't come by default. That is an option. Now, typically what happens in terms of pricing is that if you want just one option, then it might be worth your while just buying that one. But if you're half considering two or three, you can buy a package, which is probably the cost of two, which incorporates everything. So just bear that in mind. Do go to their website and double carefully check the pricing on options to see whether it's better to step up to the complete package option or just buying one or two. Now, the price points across all of these, so the Rode & Schwarz, the Keysight, and the Tektronix, you're looking at kind of 3,500 for the base units, all the way up to kind of 16,000. Now, when I say 16,000, that just over 16,000, kind of 16,500. Now, those are recommended retail prices. You may be able to find them cheaper on specials and what have you. And of course, that doesn't include the options. Once you start having a fully loaded unit like this on the bench here, with a set of differential probes and a current probe, you're talking over $20,000. So these units are certainly not the entry level, they are the mid-range in terms of oscilloscopes. Now let's get down to some of the key differences between these three manufacturers. Now the first one is a screen. The R&S has a 10.1 inch screen. It's a really nice big screen. It's also higher resolution. It's 1080 by 800. So it's a higher resolution than the Keysight or the Tektronix. And it shows. It's beautiful and crisp. It does, however, have the gloss finish. So for instance, it's a fingerprint magnet, but because it's got such a high contrast ratio and it's quite bright, You don't generally see the fingerprints until it's switched off. So while you're working on it, it's fine. It may be susceptible to reflection. You can make that call as we're filming it. Of course, I try to avoid reflection. I've not actively had an issue with reflection, but that just could be where I'm working, and that may differ for you. The Keysight has an 8.5-inch screen. The Tektronix has a 9-inch screen. Now, I will highlight Rohde & Schwarz or R&S get that bigger screen because they do have a slight compromise in terms of your horizontal knobs. They only have one and you have to select your channel. I'm going to show you that when we get down to the bench. Then in terms of vertical resolution, that's another boasting point that R&S have. By default, theirs is a 10-bit resolution. So in terms of your amplitude or your voltage measurement of your signal, that's 10-bit versus 8-bit on the Keysight and the Tektronix. Now, all of these scopes have a high resolution mode, and there the R&S jumps up to 16-bit, Keysight 12-bit, and the Tektronix, as I recall, was 11-bit. So again, it's got nice specs for the vertical resolution. When it comes to waveform updates, now this is very interesting. The R&S lags behind the other two. It is quoted at 64,000 waveform updates per second. The Keysight, which has its own very powerful hardware engine, they've got an ASIC driving that, and it really shows. That can do 1 million waveform updates per second. The Tektronix was quoted doing 280,000 waveform updates per minute. Now, I'm going to try and demonstrate this, but I've struggled. There's only one or two occasions I've managed to get the trigger out onto a counter so I can actually show that. I'll show you the kind of, and it's a fairly narrow range when you're going to get that upper end. I actually saw 70 to 85,000 waveform updates, but I've personally not seen that the scope has been sluggish in general operation. Now, the one area having that lower waveform update specification is going to hurt you is when you try to capture glitches. But the R&S RTM 3000 does have a trick up its sleeve. It does have this very configurable segmented memory. And because it's got so much memory, you've got 80 million points that you can capture. You can configure that into the number of segments or the length or the amount of capture points you want in each segment. What you can also do, there's a mode where you can ask for fast or high speed, I forget the actual name, but a fast segmented memory. And what the scope does then is it reduces its blind time by first doing the full capture of the signal coming in, then processing and displaying. Now, the one big issue, I've spoken about this in a video that I did on kind of specifications and performance of oscilloscopes, is that for the most part, oscilloscopes are blind to what they're looking at because they only spend about this much time to capture the input, the signal that you want to kind of analyze, and then it takes this much time to process and get it up onto the display. So during this period, which can be literally, you're looking at 90 to sometimes 99% of the time, your oscilloscope can be blind. You're going to miss glitches and signals which might be coming in. So during that kind of high-speed segmented capture, it can go up to 700,000 waveform updates per second. So that's a big jump up, that's higher than the Tektronix scope, and not too far off the Agilent, but you don't want to do direct comparisons because the engine, for instance, that the Keysight or the Agilent has got helps in other areas. But when you're trying to capture those signals, it's going to basically not do the processing and displaying, it's going to capture all the information first, so reducing its blind time, then process and display it. And we'll do a little demonstration of that because there are a few quirks I came across which you need to be wary of, where you can lose your data if you're not wary of what keystrokes you should be doing. So I'm going to show you that quirk when we get down to the bench. Then also we're going to have a look at it's got a logic side, it's got 16 digital channels, so you can look at logic signals, and it's got protocol decoding. Right, so let's get down to the bench. Right then, so let's take a look at the bits that do come with it. Now, when I say bits, there are a few bits which obviously, depending on which option and which level of scope you get, you might or might not have with your scope. But certainly, you with the 1 gigahertz scope, just a heads up, you get a 500 megahertz probe. Now this probe, as you can see, is a 10 to 1, 500 megahertz, and it is 9.5 picofarad in terms of its capacitive loading. Now once you start going above 500 megahertz, then you want an active probe. I have tested the bandwidth of these probes and they work very well. Certainly no big drop off at all. They'll happily work to the 500 megahertz claimed bandwidth, obviously still above the 3 dB point of drop off. With the probe, you'll also get various accessories. You get the small screwdriver to make adjustments to the probe. You get the smaller earth lead so that you haven't got this big antenna waving off if you're kind of measuring high frequency stuff, or if you're probing ICs, this can be very helpful. You then also get a spare pogo tip. So that means you can replace the pogo tip point of your probe. Depending on the options you get, you may have the logic or the digital channels, and then you get the logic probe, which has a really nice connector to the scope. This differs from the 2000 series, which has the connector on the front of the scope. This is on the side of the scope, but I'll show you that. You then have, you'll get two of these, so each of these can handle 8 channels for a total of 16. This one nicely has ground leads at the end, and then on each of your hooks, so you've got these very nice hooks where you can hook onto your IC pins or what have you, each of these has a ground lead. So where it connects to the actual probe, it's got this junction over here, and you can have a ground lead right over here. And then what I will be demonstrating or showing off towards the end of the video is I do have this very nice current probe that Rode & Schwarz put into my hands. So this one can measure up to 30 amps. So this uses a kind of more active or intelligent connector connected to the scope. And when you plug these into the scope, it'll actually bring up a settings menu so that you can, if you need to do any degaussing or zero them, that menu setting comes up straight away, and I'll demonstrate that. I think part of that, I've literally just done a firmware update to the scope to bring it up to, I think it's version 1.300. That is one of the features. So when you plug this in, you don't have to go fiddling around in menus. It automatically pops up, and you can go and set zero it or degauss it and what have you. The current probe has a very nice slide back, which allows you to put your conductor inside this gap over here. That then goes up and it actually locks to keep it secure in place. And then the other device that I got with a scope is this high voltage differential probe. It comes in a nice case. In fact, the current probe has got its own protective plastic case, but there are a few accessories with this. You're able to insert test leads or little clamps or grippers into here. I'll just show you what it comes with. This, if I remember correctly, yes, can do up to 200 megahertz and up to 750 volts. It's got various buttons on the probe where you can go and either have the range set to auto 750 or 75 volts. The bandwidth, you can either have full bandwidth or limited to 5 megahertz. And then you can set whether you want an audible sound if you overrange. It's then also got this micro button, and this is programmable. By default, I think it actually stops and starts a trigger, but we'll check that out when we have it connected up. Inside the case, I will just give you a quick brief look inside, but here are all the probes and attachments that you can actually connect to that. So whether you're working inside a DB board or doing energy measurements and the like, you get all these nice little handy clamps and bits and pieces so that you can either clamp onto, I say, breakers or battery connectors or what have you. Now, so the beauty of that is that you can do power measurements, and we'll go and have a look on the scope. It's got a whole section and applications specifically geared towards doing power and energy measurements. Right, so let's take a look at the outside of it and just have a quick navigation on what's here. You've got your power button. You've got your USB input over here, so we'll be using that later to capture things from the segmented memory. You've got probe compensation. You've got a pattern generator, which is really handy. I'm going to demonstrate that when we have a look at patterns and then also do protocol decoding. This scope has the waveform generator or function generator, which works up to 25 megahertz
for a sine wave. I think it's slightly lower for square and sawtooth. I think it drops down to 10 megahertz. You've then got a demo output. This does have, you can get training or teaching modules applications within this. So it's got a demo output. You've got your external trigger input. You've then got your intelligent channel connectors. So in this case, we've got four channels. We have the 10.1 inch screen. So as noted, a really nice big screen. It almost seems like a television when you close up to this, nice and crisp. The compromise to achieve this nice big screen, if you go and have a look at, let's say, the Keysight or the Tektronix in comparison. Now, the Tektronix is compromised because it's got even more controls on the side over here. But both the Keysight and the Tektronix have individual controls for the vertical. So they have four knobs over here. And what R&S have done, or Rohde & Schwarz have done, they've limited that to just one. You have to go and select your channel and then make your changes. But that allows you to reduce this area and give you a far bigger screen. On the side of the scope is where we have our digital channel inputs. As noted, you've got two of the probes which you'd plug in to get your channels. Each of them are going to handle eight channels for a total of 16. At the back of the scope, we've got an auxiliary output. So that can either be switched off, or you can have a 10 megahertz signal out, or your trigger out. Now, as noted, I've been trying to use that to read the trigger so I could see the waveform updates per second. But I've had that signal sometimes is not the best, and I don't get a clean output from that. We will try to say once we've got on the bench. You've got a USB host, you've got a LAN. So this can be accessible by the LAN and controlled remotely. So it's got its own remote server where you can remotely view the scope and control it via that LAN port. You've then got a carry handle. The fan is on the back here. The fan noise certainly hasn't been a bother to me at all, but again, once we have it powered up, we can see whether there's any noise coming from that. We then have your power input. That is rated for 100 to 240 volts, both 50 and 60 hertz, so it's basically international. You do have an overriding power switch. So on your bench, if you don't want it to passively pull power, then you can switch it off. You do also have the facility to securing it to a bench if you're either in a university training or a lab where lots of people are using or sharing equipment, you can lock this to the bench as well. The far end of it has all these honeycomb holes just to allow air to flow through the unit. On the underside of it, you do have a nice set of rubber bumpers on it, so it certainly grips the bench nicely. And you've got a set of feet which you can flip up if you want to angle it up towards you. Okay, so I'm about to fire up the scope to see how long it boots up. You'll see in the screen, you can note the reflection of the camera, right? So what I want to see is when we power it up and the display actually comes up, how bothersome that is. So we'll just power it on to see how long it actually takes. I've just switched it on now. There we go, booting up. And hopefully you'll see for the main part, although the screen will probably go black, is that it's not too bad when the actual screen comes up, but it's not a matte screen. So if you do have some bright light behind you or coming down from the side, you potentially can see reflections in the screen. So that's just something to be wary of. Right, so let's just have a quick tour of the controls and where some things are tucked away. Up the top here, we have our horizontal controls, which are fairly straightforward. We've got our trigger controls, which are fairly standard and straightforward. Over here, we've got a group of buttons, which is labeled action. So we've got a camera. You can take a snapshot of the screen and it'll automatically save it to a memory stick. You can load or save either profiles, setup profiles, or reference signals. You've got an auto set feature. Now I'm going to show you there's a nice addition in this latest firmware where you can actually do an auto set per channel rather than auto setting everything. You've got a touch lock. Obviously you've got a touch screen, which is very handy, but you can switch that off so that it doesn't respond. You've got a clear screen. We can then pull up presets, obviously. Underneath, we've got analysis. So this dial will change according to what menu or function you've got up. By default, it'll change the waveform intensity. If you have a look at the screen over here, you can see it'll show a percentage level for the intensity of the waveform. You've then got your cursors, measurement, your display settings, so it's to set the contrast or what have you of the screen. This quick measure, I actually gravitate to this as opposed to pulling up measurements and manually going, setting up what measurements you want taken. You've got this key which will quickly bring up a whole set of key measurements. So it'll give you the RMS cycle, the period, the frequency, and then the voltage peak to peak, and various annotations on the screen as well. You've got a search function. So if you go into the search function, here you can go and set up all kinds of things. You've got a search type. You could say the type of edge, the width, a peak. If you've got a peak which is above the rest of the waveform, it can trigger and collect that. Rise and fall time, runt, and patterns. So you've got quite a powerful search feature for trying to analyze or capturing certain events which might be more difficult to do the traditional trigger for. You've then got your FFT function. And what I really like about this FFT is that you can view both your FFT function and your normal time domain at the same time. You've then got your protocol decoding. You've got your function generator. So if we push that, you can see you can go and set the frequency. When you've got the little annotation or the arrow here, you'll see it lights up here. So you can go make changes simply by twiddling the knob. Or again, because it's touchscreen, I can go and touch that. It brings up a keypad and I can go and enter it there. If I go and set this, you can see that there it's got the maximum straight off, 25 megahertz. If I go and change the function or the waveform to, let's say, let's go to triangle, you'll see it drops down to 10 megahertz. So it's a maximum of 25 megahertz for the sine, but then it can vary for the various other waveforms. We then have this little button with all these little squares on it. That's your application button. So of course, these days, oscilloscopes have turned into mini computers with applications. And hence, it has to be said, this is where the power of the touchscreen comes into play, because trying to control all these functions and features merely with knobs can be a nightmare. Now, I've noted in videos before, I'm very old school. I love knobs and buttons versus touching on the screen. But once you've started using a touchscreen, particularly on an oscilloscope, it's actually quite difficult to go back. And I noted this when I did the review of the Keysight versus the Tektronix. The Tektronix didn't have a touchscreen, and I constantly found myself trying to touch the screen, because otherwise you're having to use a complicated series of menus and knobs to try and navigate, whereas instead of just being able to go directly to what you wanted and touching it. You've got a lot more touch functionality, but we'll look at that now. But this button then brings up a screen, and this is where traditionally I got lost. I was looking for the XY function in other menu systems, where here it is, it's tucked away on the application screen. Here the scope brings up the standard scope. You can do quick measurements, you can get your FFT, power analysis we'll have a look at, you can set up your mask, you've got your demo, your teaching mode, you can go to the function generator. So a lot of these functions are on the main screen, but obviously if you have any additional options, you can get them here. Then for instance, we've got a protocol decoding, so we've got separate things for protocol decoding. You've got your probe adjust. If we go to, for instance, power analysis, there we have a whole host of applications just under there for looking at power quality, for looking at consumption. I mean, this for me is just an absolute boon to have this functionality on an oscilloscope. You do need the current clamp and you need the differential probes if you want to do these kind of power measurements, but you can do inrush current and harmonics. And each time you select one of them, it'll give you a little graphic representation, a description, and a nice display of how to connect things up in order to take those measurements. So really, really handy. To get back, we just close down that screen. And then if you push scope at any time, it'll bring you back to the main scope screen. Taking a closer look at the screen and the controls there, as I mentioned, when you want to control the various channels, the vertical controls, you need to go and select them, and then you can use your control knobs. Now, all these knobs, I should note, has got a detent. You can push it in, for instance, your horizontal position. It'll automatically center if you're off. So if I go and push the signal off and I just go and center it, it comes back. Your horizontal scale your adjustments there. That's a coarse, you push it in and you get a fine, which I really like when you have the fine and coarse adjustments right there. Likewise for your vertical, you can make the adjustments there, or you can go onto the display and use your finger. And of course, if I have it off, I can center it back by pushing that knob. Your scale, in terms of your vertical scale for the voltage, I've got it set on fine at the moment. If I push it, it'll go to a coarse setting. And of course, you can do the pinch and zoom, well, pinch and stretch to go and change your either your vertical or your time base, your horizontal. For me, I must say, this does work relatively well. Although, again, this is where I would use the knobs and buttons versus the screen. It's nice using the screen, sometimes for using cursor measurements, so it's not fiddling around with knobs, you can just move cursors around. But I, generally speaking, wouldn't use the screen for changing the time base or the vertical settings. You know, you can, if you're careful, you can actually do fairly fine settings. And I found, like with a cursor, if you start rolling your finger across the screen, you can do a very, quite a fine job. But I still prefer coming back to the knobs. Okay, so now that we've got everything fired up, I'll just give you a quick tour of the layout and where things are. The first thing I will say, and hopefully you'll realize this from the camera, is that this screen, the resolution and the contrast ratio is absolutely brilliant. So it is very crisp. Even though you've got really small font, let's say denoting the periods across the graticules, it is crisp and clear. Also note that there are 12 periods across this, as opposed to the, let's say, standard 10. If I remember correctly, I think the Tektronix might have been 12 as well. And I think, and I stand to be corrected, that the Keysight was 10. But what the Keysight did, which can be both a pro and a con, it reduced the area of the screen so that it had space for menus to come up on the side here. So you didn't have this phenomenon of when you bring up a menu, you suddenly lose part of your screen. And as you go into something, your kind of area where your signal is shrinks again. So it had this area which kind of allowed for your menus and what have you to be up there without impinging on this, but it always meant that you lived with a slightly smaller area for your signal. Whereas here, when the menu disappears or goes away, you end up with a really nice wide area to display your signal. So here we've got a whole lot of information. You'll see what channel you're triggering on, that you've got an edge trigger, the level of your, if I go and adjust the trigger level, that shows your trigger level. I can obviously push to kind of get it centered. You then got your acquisition, that you're on auto, your sample rate. You can see your time-based settings. You can see that if there's an offset, so if I go and center that, it'll go and center. And of course, as I've noted before, you can go and chop and change all of this using touch control. As I said, not my preference, but certainly it can be done. And if you get used to it, you can navigate very well. Where the touch control is very powerful is being able to go into the menu systems and picking things out very quickly. You can have some quick access keys at the top here. Those you can configure. You can see this little button. I can highlight what I want up here to quickly access. So I don't have to go, let's say, another menu level down to get it. It's right up here. So just by touching these, I can go and add something. So if I wanted to go and add run stop onto that, you can see it's gone and added the run stop over there to fill up the menu. So I'll leave that there just for fun. Then down at the bottom of this display, you've got the information on your channels. And what's changed in the latest firmware is that you can go and click on the channel, so you can switch channels on, off, you can change various parameters like the input impedance, and you've got this auto scale. So on each channel, you can go and auto scale at a per channel basis. So there we go, I've just put on channel 2, and if I touch that, I can go and auto scale that if I wanted to, or I can go and switch it off. You can pull up the menu. When you hit the menu there, it then pulls up the channel menu here as the same that you'd get if you actually pushed the channel button on the side over here. But nice and handy that you've got that flexibility. Push the back button to take that off. If I go and push that menu button, it'll then go and slip that menu away. This menu on the side is fairly extensive. You've got all your normal controls. You've got your logic control trigger. horizontal. Obviously, some of these are on physical buttons on the side, but then there are things like, for instance, history. So this is where you can go and look at segmented history. So if I go and push that, we can then go and change parameters here for our segmented history. This was a fast segmentation that you can go and switch on and off, where it'll capture everything first before it does any processing and displaying to speed up the number of waveforms per second that you can actually get. Quite a few of these items here are physical buttons on the side, but as noted, some of them aren't. You've then got your setup. You've then got, and I showed you before, the search facility. So you've got a lot of flexibility in terms of how to get to various tools and applications or functions on the scope. If we come back, the other handy feature is, for instance, annotation. So you could go switch on annotations. I can go and select a color and I can say, I want to highlight that on the screen. We've got an issue over there and an issue over there. And then I might want to actually come in, onto the annotation. I want to put in some text. I can select text and say, this is a problem. I can enter that and there we go. So then you get the text on the screen. I can highlight things and then off to the side. Remember, I've got the camera annotation. So I've got this action button, there's a camera annotation. If I push that and I had a memory stick sat in the front of the device, that would then capture this to an image file. And I could then send that off to someone and say, hey, look at these issues on here. And of course, if I just want to clear those, there's a number of ways I could do that. There's that clear button off to the side, or if I go back into the annotations, if I can pull that up, it's got, you can either gently erase things, or I've got this kind of all clear. I think it was the alt. Doesn't that erase everything? There we go. The second time it erases everything. So that touch facility on here is actually quite intuitive and easy to use. Certainly once you get used to it, even for an old frog like me who prefers buttons and knobs. And then as noted, going into things like your applications, where you can go and select further features like your mask and your XY and your FFT and your power options or whatever functions you've got or paid for, just be aware that some of these are options, then you've got all that additional functionality tucked away here, easy to get to. Okay, so the next thing I want to talk about is kind of memory and performance of the scope. Now, as I said, one of my frustrations has been that I do have the auxiliary output doing the trigger out to a frequency counter so that I could display the waveform updates per second so we could see the performance. But for some reason, that really seems to work properly. So, but I can tell you that basically you've got a very narrow band of C when you go right, take your time base right up to your narrowest time base. That's when you're gonna have the best performance out of the scope. I've seen, in fact, 70,000 waveform updates, up to 80,000 waveform updates, which is above what they're quoting. But that will drop off as soon as you change your time base and you're seeing more, the scope has got more work to do. So that does drop off, but I've not seen the scope get sluggish. So in fact, when I was working on the Tektronix, there were certain times when I found that scope could get sluggish. The Keysight, that's got a very powerful hardware engine, so I never saw that get sluggish. But certainly the Tektronix did, but I've not seen this get sluggish. But what you will find is if you're trying to capture glitches and things like that, when the performance drops off, you've got less chance of that happening. However, as noted, I'll show you with a segmented memory, they've got that trick up their sleeve to help you with that. Right, so the next thing in terms of the way the channels are set up, let me just demonstrate the memory. The one thing I want you to take note as I make changes is the sample rate. So we're at 5 gigasamples per second, right? So that's its maximum. But channel 1 and channel 2 are interleaved, as are channel 3 and channel 4. So when you go and enable channel 2, for instance, you'll see that the sample rate halves. But if I switch off channel 2, we come back up. But if I go to channel 3, you're still going to maintain your top sample rate. So just be aware of that. If your sample rate and the performance is important, as is with the memory depth, and we're going to come down to that soon, then use, let's say, if you need a second channel, go with channel 1 and channel 3, or channel 2 and channel 4. But either if 1 or 2 are used together, or 3 and 4 are used together, then you're obviously going to see that drop. If you have all of them on, then you're still going to retain your 2.5 gigasamples per second. Right, now let's look at, if we're going to acquisition, at the moment, so the nice thing is here that you can change your record length or your memory depth. This will disappear. If you go into history, I just want to highlight this because this has caught me off. Your history needs to be set to auto. And the nice thing is that, again, your history is very configurable. If I switch that off, and I just want to make sure that I'm not losing my marbles, you'll see here I cannot change the record length. So if you're in that scenario and you want to change your record length, make sure you do go into the history and set that to auto. And then when you go into acquisition, then you've got the flexibility of being able to change. You can see it's gone and changed it down because of what was happening with the segmented memory. So I'm going to go back up to 80 megasamples. So we do that. You can see we've got 80 megasamples. That's a lot of memory. You can do a lot with that. That's the one thing I really, really like about the scope. So if I go and turn on channel 2, we see that disappears. I bring up acquisition again. You can see that's dropped to 40 megasamples, again, because these two channels are interleaved. If I go and switch off channel 2 acquisition, we're back up to 80. If I go to channel 3 and I switch that on, you'll see we still maintain that memory depth. So again, just be aware of that. If you want your best performance, channel 1 and channel 2, channel 1 and channel 3 are best to have on together, or 2 and 4. Of course, you're not always going to have that luxury, but just be aware of how they are interleaved. If I adjust the vertical, we can go all the way down to 1 millivolt. Now that both the Tektronix and the Keysight can do, this can go one step further though, down to 500 microvolts. And we're going to test the noise levels on that in a moment, but it certainly doesn't limit the bandwidth. On the Tektronix, what they do to kind of limit the noise at the 1 millivolt level is they would then limit the bandwidth. This doesn't. You still have the full bandwidth. And just to show you that, now there's another thing to be wary of. You can see it says bandwidth full here, but I'm on 1 megaohm termination. But look here, if I open that up, you'll see it actually says 500 megahertz as opposed to 1 gigahertz. So the one thing to be wary of here is that depending on your termination setting, and this caught me off guard, I actually had to call Rohde & Schwarz and ask them, you get your full bandwidth on 50 ohm. So just be aware of that. It does limit it when you go to 1 megaohm. That's not a big problem at all, but just something to be aware of. But nonetheless, so here we go, when I've got it on 50 ohm, you've still got your full bandwidth down when you've got your vertical set to 500 microvolts. The other nice feature which I like, you can see because I've got the vertical set like this, it actually shows you that in red that you've actually got something out of your field of view, if you like. If you looked very carefully at the edges of the screen, you'll see where the signal goes out, there's a little red line, basically showing you that you've got a signal out of range. So as I bring that back in, you'll see that the red disappears, and that disappears here. I'll just take it, I've set it to fine, so I can do this slowly. And as I start taking it out, you'll see it shows you. I like that feature. There've been quite a few cases when I've been using this for some work on my bench, and it's been really nice to actually see that you're out of range on something or something's off the display. Okay, and for those of you who are interested in noise levels, I've got this set down to, actually got it set on to 1 millivolt. Let's go down to 500 microvolts and we'll let the figures build up again. But you'll note, if you look at the mean values here, the RMS value is sitting at 108 microvolts. That figure for the Keysight was 272 microvolt, and for the Tektronix, that was sitting at 185 microvolt. But bearing in mind, I think with the Tektronix, there was bandwidth limiting, so they limited the noise. So that noise level is really low. And then here at the mean, you can see we're at 726 microvolt And on the key side, that was sitting at 2.6 millivolt. And for the Tektronix, that was at 1.8 millivolt. So the noise figures for this, when you sitting at this level, are really, really good. And now what I've got up on the screen, just to demonstrate the intensity grading, I've got an AM modulated signal. And if I change the intensity of the waveform, you can see we get fairly nice grading with that. So I'll just take it all the way up to 100% and then bring it down. And then what you can also do is on your channel, you can go and select if you want a different color. You've got a few choices. You've got the default rainbow, fire, and then temperature. And just as an example, we'll use the rainbow. So if we go back to that, and then you go play with the intensity grading. And that certainly seems to work very well in terms of understanding the waveform intensity at its various parts. Right, then the next thing we're going to demonstrate, I'm going to show you probably two features. The one is the mask feature, if we want to, let's say, capture a glitch, and then the segmented memory. Now, the one thing I just before we get into that, I want to demonstrate that at the moment you can see my reflection in the screen. And I've been reviewing the video and noticing my reflection as I'm filming. But what I want to highlight is I've got quite a bright light above me. So if I dip that light out, you'll see that reflection is greatly minimized. So you, unfortunately, during my filming, because I've got this light above me, the reflection is accentuated, but nonetheless, it is a shiny gloss screen versus a matte screen. So there is the risk that you can pick up more reflection, but the light above me is causing that to happen far worse than it normally would. Now, what I've got here is, let's pretend this is a clock pulse going into some form of IC or microcontroller or microprocessor, and we've got a problem. The microcontroller is glitching, there's a problem. Now, if you look very carefully, I've got a glitch which I'm introducing into this once every second. There, you might have just seen it flash across over there. Now, an infrequent glitch can be very difficult to find, because remember the oscilloscope, there's a lot of blind time. So remember, in theory, this should see it every second, but certainly it's not. You can see the sample rate is obviously low. The act waveform updates for the time-based setting that I've got won't be at its best. So the blind time is increased, and that can be a real challenge to catch those. Now, I've already said you've got the search tools to try and get it, but what I'll demonstrate is the mask and the segmented memory. So if I go into the mask, and there's a previous mask I was playing with, and now what I'm going to do is say, give me a new mask. There's the mask. I'm going to increase a little bit just to make sure that the actual signal doesn't go right. There we go. It's already captured one of those pulses. I haven't run it yet. Now, what I want to show you is what you can do in the settings down here. For one, in the setup, you can tell it to do certain things. So if I go up here, we've got, you can load and save masks. In the actions, I've told it to make a sound. I'll probably switch that off. You could get it to send a pulse. I think that goes out of the auxiliary output. So if you wanted to trigger something else when this happens, or you can get it to save the waveform. The waveform, that's the waveform data, but I've asked it to save the screenshot. So I've got a memory stick in the front and we'll review those afterwards. So we've got the screenshot set over there. I'll go back, and then on here, you can see I've got highlighted capture fails. Now, that'll ensure that it captures those glitches or the fails of the mask to the image, or I shouldn't say that, it'll save those to the segmented memory. So here we go, I'm running. At the moment, you can see how many have processed, zero fails so far. Now, what I'm going to do, I'm actually going to stop. Oh, there we go. So it's just as I was about to stop it, you can see it's already got one fail. You can see it's thinking because it's actually writing the image to the disk or the stick in the front. So there we go. It's noted that it's captured that. There we go. It's just caught another one. And this, you can sit there and let it capture for ages. Now, what I'm going to do is just show you the parameters in the history. So I'm going to, well, let me just show you something. I'm going to push run stop. And prior to that, let me see if I can pull up history. You can see I've got in the history the record length set to 8 megasamples. I can vary the number of segments. I could, obviously, the greater number of segments I set, the memory is going to increase and eventually the record length is going to have to step down. So I'm going to set this to 50. You can play with all these parameters. It tells you how much memory you need. And you can see I've got fast segmentation enabled. So that's going to enable the history or the segmented memory to capture things quicker. We've then obviously got show history. So then on the tab here, it brings up another tab where it shows you what you've captured. The important thing to note here, for you to see the segment table, you have to push run stop and then it'll list. So I'm going to do that right now, and you can see it's got some triggers because we're going to go back and run this again. But the critical thing is, if you want your work to be saved here, you could have, let's say, gone out to lunch hoping to capture something. And if you go and push the wrong key, you'll lose this data. So I'm going to push the run. So we're now running. We go back to the mask. So right, what we're going to do, we're going to reset and get this running again. As just switch back. There's nothing in the segment table. We come back to the mask. I'm going to run, start running again, and we'll wait until we get a few mask failures, and then I'll show you what potentially can go awry if you're not careful. There we go. So we've got our first one. It's captured the first one. It's captured a second one. Now, of course, you could have an anomaly or a glitch which isn't even happening as frequently as a minute or a second. It could be every minute or every few minutes, and that could take hours and hours to capture. So you may set this up to run, leave it overnight or something like that, and then come back the next day hoping to see your results. Potentially, what you're going to see, and what I want to show you again, is that there's nothing at the moment in the segment table. That will only fill up when you push run stop. But that's the hint. You might naturally think, oh, well, let me stop my mask, right? So you've got the failures here. You go to the segment table wanting to see it here so you can review it. There's nothing there. I'm going to push the run stop. You can see at the top it says complete, but there's no data. So if you stop things in the wrong order, your segmented memory will be lost. So just be aware of that. I'm going to start things again. So we're running, we're triggering. We're going to come back to the mask. I'm going to reset and I'm going to run again. So there we go. Now we're starting to get our failures coming through. I'll just let it capture a few more. Right, so in this point in time, we'll call it quits. We've got three failures, or now fourth failure for the mask. We don't push stop. I'm going to go up your note. I'm going to hit the run stop. It doesn't matter whether I stop the mask or not. Now if we go over to the segmented table, can make that a little bit bigger. You can now see, and it shows you where the clips are. If I go and have a look at these segments, there's something odd going on here. As I stop and change these, it's actually still saving them to the front disk. I'll double check that. I think there's a little flaw in the way this is operating. But nonetheless, here you can see the glitch. You can see how our clock pulse has jumped out of the mask. So something's gone awry there. I can navigate with the key on the side. So as I flick through this, you can see where things have gone awry. Now, in some cases, what you'll see, you'll still see the waveform inside the mask, but you'll see a little bit of a glitch out of it. But at least what this is telling you is that potentially you've got a problem with your clock pulse. And in fact, if I stay right there, you can see that little sharp. Let's see if we can go into it. You know what? Silly me. That writing is because I didn't stop things here. You can see the clock has already gone up to 13. So that was continuing. So we come back here. Now we can navigate without that interruption. So now if we go and have a look at the results, you can go and see what's happened over time. It's also been writing all these images as PNG files. Just be aware though, it is capturing exactly what you've got on the screen. So for instance, those last few images which were being saved will capture the smaller view up here and the table over here. So what you do want to do ultimately is set this up so you've got the best view of your signal on the display, because that's ultimately what you want to see, because it is capturing exactly what you've got on the screen.